Good evening and welcome. I'd like to begin by welcoming the members of our great legislative delegation that took the time to come. The chairman of the House Ways and Means Committee that's done so much for our city of Haverhill, State Representative Brian Dempsey. Give him a big round of applause. We're blessed to have the best state delegation in the state. And we have also our state senator, Kathleen O'Connor Ives. Thank you very much for joining us. And State Representative Diana DeZoglio. Again, thank you so much for coming here this evening. As we gather here tonight, oh, and State Representative, you're hiding back there. State Representative Linda Dean Campbell. Thank you very much, Jeff, for joining us. And I know we also have representatives from Congresswoman Tsongas's office and Senator Markey's office and Senator Warren's office. Thank you very much for coming here this evening. As we gather here this evening, spring's finally around the corner. It sure doesn't feel that way, but it is. We take a moment to recall that only a month ago, we were buried under four consecutive snowstorms that dumped a total of over 8 feet of snow in Haverhill. Our men and women worked incredibly long hours and got us through this. When the MBTA shut down, Haverhill kept going. And many of them are here this evening, led by Mike Stankovich, our DPW director. Please join in giving the men and women of the DPW a round of applause. I'd also like to recognize and thank our hardworking and dedicated city employees, many of whom are in the room with us this evening. Thank you for your service and your hard work for the city of Haverhill. Thank you all very, very much. This year is the 375th anniversary of the settlement of Haverhill. We'll have a celebration in July, and in that celebration, and tonight, we intend to celebrate our past. But tonight, I also want to tell you about the bold future that awaits us, the Haverhill of tomorrow. Over the years, we've faced many challenges and met them all. Just in my tenure, we've faced the largest municipal debt in the history of the state, a problem we still face. We've faced the recession. We've faced rising gang violence. Today, we face an entirely new set of challenges. Meeting those challenges is the key to a bright future for tomorrow. Now, when I spoke to you just a year ago, we faced almost daily reports of rising gang activity. We pledged to add more resources to our force and to use those resources in smarter and better ways to keep you safe. We started by adding more police. In the past two budgets, we've added a total of 8 new police officers. We asked for outside agencies to work with us, and they did. And with the help of Representative Dempsey again, who once again came through for us to obtain money for more patrols to high crime areas. We then became the first city in the eastern United States to obtain new software that could predict where crime was most likely to occur. Then we used our additional resources to concentrate police where they were needed the most. Today, the results are in. Last year, crime was down in the city of Haverhill by 10%. We know there's much more to do. But we also know this was a pretty good start. I think there might be members of our police department here, and whether they're here or listening on TV, please join me in giving them a great round of applause for a job well done. We've made strides on crime, but today we have an old problem that's recurred here and everywhere else: opiate addiction and opiate overdoses. Last year, we started a task force, the HOPE Task Force, to help us educate the public on this issue and to help those who want and need treatment to be able to get it. This year, we provided our first responders with Narcan, and our first responders, police and fire, have already saved 11 lives here in the city of Haverhill. We know there's more to do, and we're going to keep on working and keep on working on this important issue. A good present quality of life requires a good police presence. But if we want a great future for ourselves and our children and for the Haverhill of tomorrow, that requires great schools. 2 years ago, we put over $6 million into improvements in our schools, new roofs, new boilers, and new windows. But when I addressed you, a year ago, I said there was one school we could not fix, the Hunking School. Last year, we joined together to ask our voters for assistance, and led by a dedicated group of volunteers called Havel for Hunking, together we knocked on doors and carefully explained to voters that a new school was not a luxury, it was a necessity. And when the results came in, the voters of this city really came through, overwhelmingly for public education. Some of the parents who led that campaign are here this evening. I'd like them to stand and be recognized and thanked for a great job that they did. Where are they? The Havel for Hunking crowd. A week ago, the new Hunking School passed a major milestone. The design is now 90% complete, and in only 2 months, we'll break ground on the first new school built in our city in decades. And more importantly, we'll send a clear message. Havel stands for great education. But we can't stop there. We'll work hard to improve other school buildings. And this spring or summer, we'll add a new playground at the Tilton School. But the key to success isn't school buildings. It's what happens inside those buildings. Now here again, thanks to the leadership of Superintendent Scully and the members of the school department, we've made progress, but there's more to do. The state measures that progress in levels, with level one schools being the highest and level four being the lowest. Up until last year, outside of charter schools, we never had a level one school here in the city of Havel. But last year, thanks to the hard work of our school department, we had four level one schools in the city of Havel. But not all of our schools were level one, and we want them to be. We want every child in every neighborhood to get a first-class education here in the city of Havel. This year, the turnaround plans for our level three schools will make those schools better, but those plans must be amended to include extended learning time. Havel must be the leader in providing good schools to every resident in every section of the city. Good schools help us to keep our new young residents and attract new ones. New growth and attracting and keeping new residents is a key to the vibrant city of tomorrow. Now, thus far, most of our new growth has been concentrated downtown. But when we got started a little over a decade ago, there were almost no new young residents living downtown. Today, our downtown is 850 new residents. Yahoo.com Realty said that our downtown restaurant zone can match those of capital cities. Today, the Havel Renaissance, the vision we spoke about a little over a decade ago, has become a reality with $150 million in new investment in our downtown. This didn't happen by accident. It happened because we put together a detailed plan to attract investment in our downtown and then work together to implement that plan. All throughout the cities, buildings that were once abandoned, the symbols of our past, are now being redone as symbols of our future. The abandoned Hamel Leather Factory has become Hamel Mills Lofts. The abandoned Fifth Avenue Shoe Shop has become the Cordovan. But the best is yet to come. The Havel of tomorrow will include an even more vibrant downtown that's oriented to the waterfront and where even more of our abandoned buildings are being reused as mixed-use buildings. This spring, the Havel Music Center will be reborn as mixed-use development. Across the street, the building called the Surplus Office Supply Building will be redone. And further down the street, thanks to the phenomenal work of Representative Dempsey and the partnership of the Havel Foundation and the Planning Office of Urban Affairs, and I know that some of them are here this evening, the wonderful Harbor Place project that everyone's talking about will become a reality. And to those who made that great project possible, thank you. The project will include a boardwalk all along the river. We'll remake our downtown and our waterfront for decades to come. Harbor Place will and already has sparked new interest in our city. And to those who made it possible, again, thank you. The momentum built in the city proves the old adage, success breeds success. Today, there's really only one large abandoned eyesore building left downtown, the abandoned concrete building at 112 Essex Street. Tonight, I'm proud to announce that this abandoned eyesore is under agreement to be put back to use as a mixed-use housing and retail project. That project, if approved by the council and by the state for historic tax credits, will add an additional $22 million in investment in our downtown. I'm pleased tonight to introduce Mike Matos from Peabody Construction, who's leading this historic rehabilitation project. Mike, thank you very much. Thank you for your investment in our city. Our downtown is the envy of all the cities in the Commonwealth, but not all of our progress is downtown. We've worked hard to streamline permitting and make Havel inviting for business. Our tradition of bringing in new business continues tonight. In the industrial park off of Broadway, we welcome a new business this evening, Tremcar USA Inc., specialists in truck tanks, which will employ 15 people and bring that business to the city of Havel. And in the industrial park off of Broadway, we've worked hard with Southwick to make certain they resisted the urgings of other states to get them there and instead remained and expanded here. Southwick will expand, keep 490 jobs here in the city of Havel, add 75 new jobs, at least 30% of which must be for Havel residents. The people from Southwick are here, and I want to thank them for their investment here in the city of Havel. In the Havel of tomorrow, like the Havel of today, we'll be so proud to say for years to come that nearly every Brooks Brothers suit made in America is made right here in Haverhill, Massachusetts. Our progress has been recognized by articles in the Wall Street Journal, Boston Magazine, Chronicle, and many others. And just last year, Money Magazine rated us as one of the top five cities to live in Massachusetts. But we already knew that, didn't we? Our progress has also been recognized by Wall Street. A short decade ago, our bond rating was tied for the lowest in the state. Today, our bond rating is the highest it's been in our 300-year history. Our progress isn't limited to downtown and business parks. We've worked hard to improve every neighborhood in the city, but there's more to do. In Riverside, our Water Street Improvement Project has opened up the river and made Water Street and the Buttonwoods Trails visible again for the first time in decades. In the Havel of tomorrow, Water Street will be a linear park where residents can ride a bike, walk, or picnic along a beautiful view overlooking the waterfront. We've made improvements to Riverside Park, and this year we'll announce a program to do more. In Bradford, we break ground this spring on completing the first phase of the new rail trail in Bradford. The Havel of tomorrow will include a rail trail as part of a beautiful series of parks and playgrounds, an emerald necklace all along the waterfront. But government can only do so much. Much of the investment along the waterfront must come from the private sector. The waterfront zoning law we passed last year will begin to bear fruit this year, and new projects will come before the city and the city council along the waterfront. The vision that you and I have talked about for so long, the vision to reorient Havel along the waterfront, is becoming a reality. In the Mount Washington and Lower Acres areas, we've made improvements to the Constantino School and the Tilton School. Thanks to a state grant, we've put in over $1 million to improve Swayze Field. And this year, we'll finish phase two. We've improved playgrounds and aggressively attacked and forced the rehabilitation of abandoned and blighted buildings. But it's not buildings that make a neighborhood, it's people. Now, not all of our residents, particularly those in our inner city, can see or feel the improvements that have been made throughout the city. Instead, they see areas where crime is going down, but they also see, as we do, that there's more to do. Now, when you look at a crime map of Havel, you notice something astounding. There are only two areas in the city where there's any substantial crime at all. And there are whole sections of the city where there was not a single crime at all last year. The areas where there has been some crime is where we've concentrated our resources. Now, if you overlay those areas with another map, our home ownership map, you'll notice that the more homeowner occupants you have in an area, the lower the incidence of crime. A century ago, we saw the same problems in the same area. And we saw a generation of immigrants move into those same areas on the hill and in the acre, buy homes, fix them up, and fix up their neighborhoods. This isn't something I read about in a history book or learned about in a classroom. It's something I saw with my own eyes as my immigrant grandparents worked 15 to 18 hours a day until they could no longer stand, then came home to fix their homes, work their gardens, and build neighborhoods that were clean and safe. That same principle, the principle that first-time home buyers can fix a home and then fix at the same time the entire neighborhood, that principle can work again today. Last year, we used some of our federal block grant money to provide opportunity for 5 first-time home buyers to buy homes and then live in them in the inner city. 2 of those urban pioneers are here this evening, and I'd like to introduce and welcome them, Mr. and Mrs. Pedro Alvarado and Sandra Ramos. Welcome. Now it's time to expand that program. Tonight, I'm proud to announce our expanded first-time home buyer program. This coming year, we'll take some of our toughest streets and use our federal block grant money to incentivize up to 10 new families to buy and rehabilitate homes they'll live in and care for a minimum of 5 years. The Havel of tomorrow must include clean streets, safe streets, and good schools in every single neighborhood in the city. The Havel of tomorrow must also be affordable. Today, our residents face rapidly rising electric bills. To try to help our residents, we're instituting our new municipal energy aggregation program. The concept is simple. Bundle all of the bills for all city residents together, go out to bid with different electric companies, and try to get our residents a better deal. This has worked to lower the electricity bills of residents in other cities. We don't know for certain if it'll work here, but we do know for certain that our residents are hurting. We also know the words of President Franklin Roosevelt. It's common sense to take a method and try it. If it fails, admit it frankly and try another, but above all, try something. And we will try something for our residents. Now, for all our progress, we know there are challenges ahead. Today, the HALE debt's still with us, and we still need assistance with us, and the state's been so generous in the past. Today, we're faced with new burdens, the burdens of our new federal stormwater and sewer regulations. Those new federal regulations will require millions of dollars in capital costs and millions more in operating costs. Meeting those new challenges will be difficult and will require us to constantly find ways to make government more efficient. Our need to constantly innovate is why, late last year, we installed a new constituent services software called MainStar, making us one of the technology leaders in the state, and making it easier and more efficient for our DPW to handle 919 constituent requests, repair 15 storm drains, trim 68 trees, repair 23 sidewalks, and so far this year, patch 308 potholes with many more to go. Our need for constant innovation is why this year we'll take the steps to turn our old landfill into a solar farm, which over the next 20 years will generate $7.5 million in new revenue for our taxpayer. And that's why later this year we'll introduce a new energy saving program for our schools to help them improve our schools and save money on energy. We know there are challenges ahead, and we will meet them. But for all of the challenges that we know lie ahead, we also know this. We've weathered the past decade and come out better than anyone ever dreamt we could. And we know that working together, we've met every burden climbed every mountain, and made this city the great city we are tonight. Last week marked the last day of winter and the last day of the Woolworth Building. And tonight marks the dawn of a new era for our city. So tonight I can tell you confidently, our future is bright and the state of our city is strong. Thank you for listening. Thank you so much. Please join me downstairs for reception in the mayor's office. Thank you so much. Thank you.